My 0.4 millimeter nozzles are obsolete video apparently left quite a few questions in need of answering, at least going by the comments on that video. So today we're going to look at whether you can maybe just stick with your 0.4 millimeter nozzle and tell your slicer to pretend it's a 0.6, how strength compares between the nozzle sizes, and whether comparing 0.4 with an old slicer to 0.6 with the new one was even fair in the first place. I hope it didn't hurt the nozzle's feelings. But you know who's not going to hurt your feelings? Today's sponsor, Private Internet Access. There are plenty of VPN services around, but this is the one that I actually personally use. A while ago, I compared VPN providers, and Private Internet Access ended up being the one that checked all the boxes for features like port forwarding, a no-log policy, and fast servers without throttling or filtering, while also being one of the most affordable options. Private Internet Access hides your IP address and encrypts your internet connection. This way, it shields your digital life from the eyes of your internet service provider, network administrators, and government sensors. The client is open source, but you can use any of your own OpenVPN or WireGuard compatible clients as well. Private Internet Access now has servers in 84 countries and every single US state, so you can experience the internet as if you were practically anywhere in the world. And PIA does, of course, work with all of your favorite streaming services. Their no-log policy has recently been audited by Deloitte, and they've independently confirmed that PIA has no way of keeping track of how, when, or how much you use their VPN service. It comes out to just over $2 a month, plus if you use this link, also down in the description below, you get an extra 3 months for free. If you need it, they have 24/7 live chat support, and you can try them risk-free with their 30-day money-back guarantee. Thanks again to Private Internet for sponsoring this video. So let's start out with whether the comparison was fair or whether it even made sense to compare things where it was changing two variables at once. Well, here's the thing. Changing two variables at once was the entire point of the video. My argument was that the detail gain from the new arachne slicing would at least cancel out the amount of detail you'd lose from more than doubling the nozzle orifice area. And I would argue that it does, and that a 0.6 millimeter nozzle maybe even should be the new standard. And in the end, comparing 0.4 to 0.6 and then arachne to non-arachne would be pretty one-sided. Of course, arachne is going to print better than the classic slicing, and of course 0.6 is going to print slightly worse than 0.4, but the combination of both changes is what I was interested in. As a German, we like car analogies, so I mean, changing one variable at a time would be like filling up your Yaris with E85, noticing it actually makes less power now, and concluding that any drag racer who doesn't run premium unleaded must be completely out of their mind. But there is more than just one variable you have to change at the same time to get a benefit out of E85. You have to do the same here to find a compromise that's overall better than what you started with. Hope that makes sense. So, what about strength then? Well, this one is actually hard to compare because, well, you're changing many variables at once. I know, I just argued against that being a problem, but the question of whether the nozzle itself is the cause and the source of those strength changes you probably will be seeing, that is nearly impossible to answer. First of all, 0.6 has a wider extrusion width. So by default, when you set the slicer to print two perimeters, well, you'll actually be getting a thicker shell and more material with the 0.6. So with these two sample prints, both done at 0.2 millimeter layer height, two shells, 15% infill, the 0.4 millimeter nozzle print is 79 grams and the 0.6 millimeter nozzle print is 86 grams. Quite the difference. With infill, the wider extrusion width isn't going to result in more material being laid down because the slicer will just stretch out the infill pattern to make up for the thicker lines. And overall, it's going to end up with roughly the same amount of material. But since the pattern is wider, it's still going to perform differently to the finer one done with a 0.4 millimeter nozzle. I would think that a finer pattern with the finer nozzles would be a more homogeneous structure and therefore stronger overall, but I have not tested this. So, you know, with all these things changed at the same time, I don't think any differences in strength would be down to just the different nozzle size. They'd almost exclusively be caused by all the supporting changes that come along with that. Overall, I would assume that part strength for the same amount of material wouldn't change much. And if anything, since I mostly print mechanical and functional parts that do need a fair bit of strength, I appreciate the little bit of extra material being laid down with the 0.6. So, do you actually need to swap your nozzle, or can you just pretend your 0.4 is a 0.6? Well, kinda. I did my test plates with a 0.4 sliced 4.4, a 0.6 sliced 4.6, and a 0.4 printing the G-code sliced 4.6. Why would you want to do that? Well, maybe you don't want to buy another nozzle, or you just prefer to keep these smaller nozzle size installed in case you do want to print some finer detail models at some point. Or maybe you don't know that you have to physically change the nozzle instead of just changing the slices settings. I've had one person reach out to me who ran into that issue, but I mean, it all started somewhere, and it's a long learning journey all along. Side note, actually, what I'm doing here between the 0.4 and the 0.6 is actually changing between the presets Prusa have created for the different nozzle sizes. And those are full presets that change all the necessary options. But if you've got a profile that you'd like to convert to 0.6, best case is that you just change the nozzle size in the printer settings, and most slicers do a really good job of calculating all the detail settings automatically from that. But if you have set up overrides for those detail settings, especially the extrusion width settings, the nozzle size setting for the printer itself will actually make almost no difference in the G-code that's being output. So if you have the override set up for your 0.4, you will essentially still be slicing for a 0.4mm nozzle if you just change the setting for the printer. You know, you can change it to 0.6, 0.8, it doesn't make that much of a difference. So check those settings in Print Settings Advanced, and if in doubt, just set all the extrusion width settings to 0, and Prusa will automatically figure them out for you. So what happens when you print at 0.6mm settings with a 0.4? Well, certainly your printer isn't going to explode or anything, and in fact, all three sets of parts look totally fine. On the simple lowish poly tree frog by Moreno Pay, there is practically no difference to be seen. The Pirate and His Rat by Eastman also looks perfectly fine on all three settings, and as expected, the 0.4 sliced for 0.6 overall actually looks more like 0.6 than 0.4, but it actually looks better in a couple of spots. This overhang on the hat up here is pretty extreme, and both the 0.4 and the 0.6 are struggling with it. However, the 0.4 nozzle with 0.6 G-code does look the cleanest out of the bunch. Huh, here's what I thought was gonna happen. The way that overhangs get printed is that you have a limited amount of overlap between the current extrusion line and the one below it on the previous layer. Now, if you use a 0.4mm nozzle, but slice for 0.6, my thinking was that the material that actually gets extruded would be thinner than what the slicer expected, and as a result would just squirt right past the previous layer instead of catching it with its edge, and you would get super droopy loops as a result. But it looks like there is something else going on that has the opposite effect, and I can't quite explain it. Maybe, if you have a theory, leave it in the comments below. Where this wacky combination of slicer settings and nozzle size does fall a little short though, is with bridges and the subsequent solid infill over it. And the same with solidly infilling, you know, your top layers. It's prone to having some holes in it. But, I mean, that's something that can be tweaked out with the extrusion width settings I mentioned earlier. The Tom test shows the same effects where our Frankenstein prints are better at overhangs than both the correct 0.4 and the correct 0.6 prints. And overall, the print does look cleaner and more detailed than the one done with a 0.6mm nozzle and the correct settings for that. I went into this thinking that, you know, there's no way that this would be a good idea, but it looks like actually sticking with a 0.4mm nozzle and using a 0.6mm profile, or even just slightly wider extrusion width, could be a pretty good idea overall. And with Arachne, the slicer can now dynamically scale back those extrusion widths if it needs to. One thing that still needs more investigation is why these Frankie prints are so matte. But matte PLA prints typically indicate that, you know, your print temperatures are too low. Perhaps, I'm just speculating here, that's because the filament moves more quickly through the actual 0.4mm bore, so it has less time to pick up heat. That should be compensated by the shorter distance that the heat has to travel through the filament. I don't know, I can't explain it, but it might be a pointer that these hybrid prints printed at the wrong settings might have some disadvantages when it comes to part strength. So having done these comparisons, one thing that I wanted to know was what would happen when you do the reverse using a 0.6 millimeter nozzle and G-code slice for 0.4. Well, this doesn't work. I mean, yes, it still prints, but the parts and especially bridges and overhangs look worse than any of the other parts. So if you think about using a 0.6 millimeter nozzle and just switching to a 0.4 millimeter print profile for more detailed parts, don't. It's not gonna work. It's not a good idea. But yeah, the other way around, totally viable, I think. At the very least, it's a good preview of what it can get with a real 0.6 millimeter nozzle, but it might be good enough as a permanent solution. Though, keep in mind that this was done at 0.2 millimeter layers, and the story might look completely different at lower or higher layer heights. I wish I had more time to investigate, but I'm having to move out of this new studio space again, and that is taking up all of the time that I currently have. In any case, thank you for watching. Hope you found this interesting. Thanks to all the supporters that support my journey. Keep on making, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.